afternoon and thanks for joining us. I'm Judy Simpson. As we close out another week here on Across the Fence, we're opening up our 60th anniversary archives. For today's Friday flashback, we're going back to 1997. Former Across the Fence producer Lyn Jarvis took his camera and gear with him for a trip to Ireland. And Lyn shared this report beginning in Limerick, Ireland, on the banks of the Shannon River.
Because of the moderate temperatures, swans can be seen year-round on most of Ireland's rivers, and the Shannon is no exception. The longest river in the country, it runs 231 miles, and at Limerick, its fresh water meets the salt of the sea. Because of Limerick's location, the Vikings settled here more than 1,000 years ago, and it served as a base for raiding nearby monasteries and Celtic settlements. Today, Limerick is a commercial and tourist center in Ireland's fourth largest city. The narrow streets with attached row buildings are found throughout the city and are fun to explore. But it's the people that make Ireland so memorable. The family unit is strong, and children learn about respect and responsibility from their mother and father, who learned it from their parents and generations of parents before them. That evening, we got an idea of how royalty used to live by attending a medieval feast at Bunratty Castle. Dating from 1425, it is one of the finest tower houses still standing in Ireland. Greeted by the Lord of Bunratty, we were served mead, a legendary drink made with honey that can be traced back many centuries before Christ. Upon entering the Great Hall, we were entertained in royal fashion. Dinner was served and eaten in typical medieval fashion, by candlelight, and we drank soup from bowls. We ate spare ribs, chicken, and vegetables with fingers and a dagger. It was the perfect way to spend our first night in Ireland. And as we left, a lone bagpipe player entertained. We traveled in this very comfortable motor coach. And that's John Fitzgibbon, our guide, getting off the bus, followed by our driver, Kevin Murphy. Driving in Ireland is a challenge for Americans because of left-hand driving and roundabouts. It's nothing that I would enjoy without a lot of practice. John was from Cork. He was a lot of fun, well-organized, and kept everyone happy.
Good morning. I hope you all enjoyed the banquet last night. Today we're heading up to the Cliffs of Moher, leaving Limerick, heading northwest up to the Cliffs of Moher. Stop there for a while before we travel over the beautiful Burren area and into Galway City and spend a little time there before we head south back into Limerick. We'll be back in here roughly about mid-afternoon.
While we listen to some music by the contemporary Irish composer Phil Coulter, here are some sights from Ireland's western coast and picturesque Sleighhead Drive on the Dingle Peninsula.
That's some beautiful scenery there along Sleighhead Drive on the Dingle Peninsula, isn't it? I don't think there's anything like it anywhere else. Our next destination was Killarney, but we were a little late getting there because of one of those typical Irish traffic jams.
Hundreds of sheep were being moved from one field to another, and since main highways are the only place without fences, that's where the action is. All vehicles stop and wait for the sheep to pass, and can you imagine such a thing happening here in the U.S.?
If he got a baby in his his arm? Yes, he does.
We don't know where they're going now. Hopefully they're not going to Tulare.
Yeah, right.
Because if they are, then your two-night stay is going to be a one-night stay.
There are more than a million sheep in Ireland and an important part of the country's economy, and it seemed like the whole million were passing in front of us. They finally got to their gate, and the sheep were as happy as we were to get to their new pasture. Only in Ireland. We made it to Killarney with no stops after that. The next morning we picked up the pace just a bit by taking a jaunting cart to the Muckross House and Gardens. I was in a two-horse jaunting cart driven by a real Irishman, John Meyer.
When you go home, you can tell the rest of the Yanks that are open the gypsies' hearts.
As we neared Muckross House, we got a look at the beautiful Killarney Lakes on the horizon. And after a short stop, we were on our way again. And it wasn't long until we saw Muckross House in the distance, framed by rows of stately chestnut trees. The estate was built in 1840 and served as a private residence until recent times when the Elizabethan-style mansion was converted into a museum. When we arrived, John put what he called the fire escape in place, and one by one we climbed down from the jaunting cart. And after a quick goodbye in Gaelic, we headed for the gardens. Being mid-May, it was the perfect time to tour these magnificent gardens, and they certainly lived up to our expectations. From the beautiful gardens at Muckross House in Killarney, we traveled the 126-mile drive known as the Ring of Kerry, located on the Ivernagh Peninsula, known for its spectacular scenery and friendly people.
We're in County Cork now, and behind me is the Blarney Castle, built in 1446, and it's a must on any visit here to Ireland. Now, what makes the castle so famous is that the Blarney Stone is here. It's located in the parapet way up at the top of the castle, and they say if you kiss that stone, it gives you the gift of eloquence or the gift of gab. Now, it's a very sacred stone, and let me tell you why. It was brought here during the Crusades. It was found at the crossing of ley lines. And that means it was found where the lines of latitude and longitude intersect. It's a very sacred stone, sometimes called the Stone of Scone. It was brought here during the Crusades. Half the stone is placed under the chair where the kings and queens of England are crowned, and the other half is here at Blarney Castle. Let's go and see what's happening.
Although it was raining, people still climbed the 129 slippery circular steps and stood in line to kiss the Blarney Stone. It's not an easy task either. You must lie on your back and, with the help of an Irish gentleman, push back as far as you can and plant a kiss. Now it was my turn.
Hold the bars now.
Yeah?
Head down now, sir.
Head down. How far is it?
Way down there now, right in there.
I'm a little scared to death, but
right in there,
I wonder how many people have kissed this before me.
My turn. And there you go.
Well, I don't know if I got the gift of gab, but
have that all right.
I do know I appreciate all your help.
Well, that was an experience for all of us.
The battle cry here in Ireland is shop till you drop, and there's a good reason why. The country has some of the finest examples of china, crystal, linen, and these beautiful woolen sweaters. Let's just take a look at some of the varieties you can get here in the country of Ireland. Thank you. One of the most popular things you can buy here in Ireland are these Aran sweaters. Let me tell you a little about their origin. The Aran Islands are three small islands off the western coast of Ireland, and most of the people there are fishermen. When they aren't fishing, the men and the women make sweaters like these. They're usually a natural color with different patterns on the front, and that serves a very ominous purpose. When the men go out on the fishing boats, sometimes storms come up, sometimes the men are washed overboard, and sometimes the whole boat goes up on the rocks and the whole crew is lost. When their bodies wash ashore, they can be identified by these patterns on the front of the sweater. And that's the story of these Aran sweaters. I chose this one. It's a little bit off-white. It'll feel really good this winter during the cold days, and it'll always remind me of my stay here in Ireland.
No trip to Ireland is complete without a stop at the Waterford Crystal Factory in County Waterford. And just look at this exquisite chandelier that hangs in the main foyer. Each piece is a miracle of light, heat, and the talents of a skilled crafter. We walked through the factory and saw these talented workers. Their tools and techniques have changed little since the factory opened in 1783. They transform glowing balls of crystal into elegant shapes using artistic instinct and traditional tools such as hollow iron rods and homemade wooden molds. After the crystal has cooled, it is ready for marking and cutting. The crafters work amidst the constant whir of revolving cutter wheels and the grinding of crystal to create the deeply cut, distinctive Waterford patterns. When we travel with Marge and Bert McBride, we stay in the best of places, but this time they've really outdone themselves. We're going to spend the night in County Kildare in Kilkee Castle just behind us. Marge, tell us a little about the history of the castle.
I'd be glad to, Lyn. The castle, built in 1181, is suspected of being haunted. It was the home of the Wizard of Earl, a sorcerer whom legend says was skilled in the ways of witching and the arts of darkness. Kilkee Castle was also the home of such royalty as Sir Walter de Riddlesford, Lady Nugent, daughter of the Viscount Devlin, and Hugh de Lacy, Lord of Meath. We wondered whose rooms we might be sharing and contemplated historic events that might have been celebrated in the elegant dining hall and surmised about the spells that the Wizard of Earl might have cast here. But we were sure that on this particular night, the spell cast was that of mirth and conviviality.
We're in Dublin now, the capital of Ireland, and it's a bustling place. I'm standing on the banks of the Leffe River that run through the city of 1 million people. It's an old city, was first settled by the Vikings back in the 9th century. Big cities aren't high on my list of places to visit, but there are a lot of interesting things to see here in Dublin.
Among the highlights is Trinity College, founded in 1592 by Elizabeth I on the site of an Augustinian monastery. It's a liberal arts college with some 10,000 students from throughout the country. But we weren't here to visit students, but rather see a rare artifact housed in the Trinity College library. The famous Book of Kells, a manuscript of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, composed in Latin in the year 800 at the Kells Monastery. Another historic place we visited was the beautiful St. Patrick's Cathedral, dedicated in 1254. The cathedral has been enlarged over the years, with the present tower dating from 1370. One is awestruck when considering the antiquity of Ireland's treasures, all many hundreds of years preceding the founding of our own country. All this sightseeing has brought on an appetite, and food is plentiful and delicious in Ireland. Typical of the pubs and eateries is Bewley's Oriental Cafe in Dublin, started and still owned by Quakers. Let's skip the main course and go right to the dessert. I always say life is short, eat dessert first. I chose the chocolate-covered cream cake, and yes, it was as good as it looked.
I hope you've enjoyed this visit to the Emerald Isle. We've shown you the beauty of Ireland, but there's a lot more than that. It's like stepping back in time. Life slows down a little bit. There are no interstates, there are no high-rises, and material things aren't as important as family and friends. I know you're going to love the country if you ever get a chance to visit, but if you can't, I hope from this across-the-fence visit you can see why Ireland is one of the most popular tourist destinations in Europe. I'm Lyn Jarvis here in Ireland, and thanks for watching.